DJ Carey, the Dodger himself. After him there was Ollie Baker. DJ steadying himself, turning it in beautifully and putting it over the bar, and he's now got a goal and 4 points. That's a
fantastic... This moment of magic by Kilkenny's DJ Carey in the 2002 All-Ireland Hurling Final typifies the hurling skill of the county, with an unrivalled tradition and love of the national game as they powered their way to their 27th All-Ireland senior hurling title. The modern story of Kilkenny hurling begins in Tullerone, North Kilkenny, the 1st of November 1884, where three young men, Ned Tehan, Jack Hoyne and Henry J. Maher, on the invitation of Michael Cusick, headed for Hayes's Hotel in Thurles.
Ned played in 6 All-Irelands before Kilkenny won an All-Ireland. Jack Hoyne was on the first winning All-Ireland team in 1904. They accompanied Henry Maher to Thurles in a pony and trap. There was a trophy won outright here by Tullerone on behalf of Kilkenny in 1902, and it was presented to Laurie's father, Henry, in recognition of his work for the GA and as well he was being a founder member. And a lot of people think that that trophy is associated with Laurie, but Laurie would have only been 4 years of age when it was presented to his father.
Tullerone, captained by James Grace, won the first county hurling championship by beating Mooncoin in the county final in April of 1887. They were well beaten in the All-Ireland semi-final by Thurles, who went on to win the first All-Ireland hurling final. The GAA and the Land League were closely interwoven in the 1880s. Hurling and football matches were ideal meeting places for political meetings, despite the concerted efforts of the RIC.
They were all Irishmen, but they were paid by Britain. And they suspected, and I suppose they had reason to suspect, that the GA and the hurlers was fostering subversive movements. I know several hurling pitches around Tullerone here, up a plateau on top of the hills, a big flat field on top of the hills, and that's where they played. And the lookouts would stay, and the police would be seen coming up there, and they'd be all gone. The boys would be gone, they'd be vanished.
In 1888, county champions Mooncoin became Leinster champions. Later in the year, however, the championships were interrupted and eventually abandoned because of the US invasion. This was an exhibition party organised by Morris Davin that played a number of matches to help establish the GAA in America. Michael Corden from Castlecomer and John Fox from Mooncoin were joined by James Grace from Tullerone on the tour. With the establishment of the GAA and the success of Charles Stewart Parnell's parliamentary party, the 1880s was a wonderful decade for nationalism. The three Fs, fair rent, free sale, and fixity of tenure were conceded in 1881. And by February 1890, when Parnell was cleared of terrorism charges, the uncrowned King of Ireland was at the height of his power. Within a few short months, however, triumph quickly turned to tragedy, when following a sensational divorce case, Parnell was named as correspondent by Captain O'Shea in his wife's adultery.
He electioneered around Tullerone, and one of the houses he came to was outhouse, because of my grandfather. The Land League came into being, and my grandfather founded it here in Kilkenny, and my grandmother was secretary of it. On the morning he left, my poor mother was Dorothy Welsh, and her sister was Cecilia Welsh and Anne Welsh, three sisters. And he gave them a medal apiece that they were after bringing out. And I have that medal.
By 1893, however, the influence of the GAA in particular would help heal the split. And over the next 10 years, Kilkenny would appear in 5 All-Ireland finals. They lost all 5, but in 1904, Tullerone made the vital breakthrough by beating the legendary Rockies and All-Ireland champions Blackrock of Cork 1-9 to 1-8 in the final. This was the start of Kilkenny's greatest hurling era, when they won 7 titles in 10 years and could have won another 4. The 1906 Leinster final was lost by having to play without the Tullerone men because of a dispute over the goalkeeper. And in the 1914 Leinster final against Laois, Kilkenny got what seemed a perfect winning goal near the end, but when spectators invaded the pitch, the referee disallowed the score. It may have been some consolation to Kilkenny that year that Moon Coyne's Bob O'Keefe was a guiding light in Laois hurling.
There was a Bob O'Keefe who was from Glen Grant, Moon Coyne, and he was a school teacher in Laois, and he became a Leinster chairman and president of the GAA. And the Leinster Trophy, which is the biggest trophy in GAA, is named after him.
This is the village of Glen Grant, South Kilkenny. You couldn't go any farther, you jump out in the shoe up there. But all the houses across there, they were all thatch. There were seven houses at one time, they had 10 statute acres.
Bob got his All-Ireland medal when Laois had a sensational win over Cork in the 1915 final.
He was near the end of his days at the time, and it was in full back he was playing. And the, like Michael O'Hare had said, the Shamozzle was below in the Cork goal, because the ball came into him anyway, and he poked it as hard as he could, and rolled in the Cork goal. Nobody noticed it.
Many of Kilkenny's legendary hurling records were set in that great era.
Take the Dial family of Moon Coyne. They won 19 All-Irelands, 18 of them on the field of play, and won a sub. You take the Graces of Tullerole, I think they won 14 All-Irelands as a family. There was a Drug Welsh of Moon Coyne. He played full-back with his club, Moon Coyne, and he played centre-back with Kilkenny. Jack Ratchett was the full-back, he couldn't play full-back. But he played in 7 All-Irelands, won the 7, captained 3 of them, and he never lost an All-Ireland.
Naturally, hurling had to take a back seat to political affairs in this period. The 1916 Rising, the death of Terence McSweeney on hunger strike in 1920, all caused delays and cancellations in the GAA calendar. There was a lot of confidence in the political process when De Valera went to London in January 1921.
Great excitement for the arrival of a visitor to the Prime Minister from Unhappy Ireland. During the meeting, prayers in the streets for an agreement. What happened in that De Valera discussion, who can say but himself? But though he opposed petition to the hilt, that was the time the Irish Free State was born.
The treaty and the first Dáil in January 1922 didn't bring the much desired peace. The GAA calendar was again seriously disrupted by the Civil War. The shooting of Michael Collins at Béal na Bláth cast a shadow across the country.
And at this lovely sunny morning, I was going up to Ballyragget for the paper. And I saw this man in uniform come down the road, and he was in clay, he was wobbling a bit. But uniforms weren't the nicest thing to see at that time, you know, and they were a bit frightening too. And I got a bit nervy, if you like. But when he came up to me anyway, he put up big hands and he said, he stopped me and I got off the bike. I said, it's the best thing to do. And he said to me, Dad, he said, did you hear the news? And I said, I didn't, Shells, I didn't hear the news. I knew who he was. But I didn't hear the news. He said, they killed the big fella, he said, yesterday evening. Because the big fella, that's what he used to call Collins. And he told me there, I was in. And the tears were coming down his eyes. They said that time, and I thought everything went terribly quiet. But what they said at that time, when the news of Collins that came, the birds stopped singing. Now that was the way, that was the way that Collins was regarded by most people.
Kilkenny had beaten Dublin in the 1922 Leinster final and went into collective training for the delayed All-Ireland final against Tipperary in August 1923. The team was trained by Paddy Icy Lanigan and Mick Dalton. A huge crowd watched a very exciting final. Tipperary were leading with 3 minutes to go, but Paddy Donoghue and Dick Tobin, with a goal apiece, sealed the issue for Kilkenny.
Matty Dunphy was the captain of the team that beat Tipperary in the All-Ireland final, and Tommy Carroll from Poland was also on that team. And then Matty went on to become, as captain of the first Kilkenny captain to bring home the Railway Cup in 1927. And of course, I mustn't forget his brother, Eddie, was full forward on the 1922 team.
Kilkenny beat Laois in the 1923 Leinster final and met Galway in the All-Ireland semi-final. Both teams stayed in Barry's Hotel on the Saturday night.
And who came in but five or six of the Kilkenny players and the captain. Dick Grace was in there. And he was the principal speaker. And he was telling them how he was going to retire after Dáil Éireann and settle down and get married and get out of Ireland. And Dick Morrissey gave me an elbow and he said, "Did you hear that?" "Faith, I did," I said. He didn't say it all. He says, "For all Ireland, he'd retire after. By heavens, he won't be in this spot." Well, God, we made a show of them next day. Three goals and 10 points to 6 points. That was the score. So that man was rightly out of his opinion.
Kilkenny, helped by 5 goals from John Roberts, beat Galway in the 1926 semi-final in Croke Park. Kilkenny's final opponents, Cork, had to meet Tipperary 3 times to decide the issue in Munster.
There was 3 Mars hurling in 26. Bill was playing cornerback. Norrie was playing centre field. And Henry was playing full forward. And Bill Mars cleared the ball. And Norrie connected with it. And Henry drove it over the bar in 26. And Cork beat the lard out of Kilkenny.
Henry Maher then went to the USA, but returned to play with a United States team against an Ireland selection in the Tarleton Games in 1928. A noticeable feature of Kilkenny hurling is the number of hurling dynasties that exist across the county.
We were after putting the cattle on the rail above and came back down the town. And who did we meet? Only Little Sim, that was Captain Sim. My father himself was very great. And went into Jimmy Connell's here in High Street. And who arrived in after him? Only Jack Rashford. And so Rashford was doubtful back a pal of theirs again. Rashford said to Little Sim, "God damn it, only for us Wharton, you'd have near a hurler." That's the way he said Wharton. That was the way of putting it. "Only for us, you'd have near a hurler." "Oh, my boy, what do you mean?" "Well, sure, we sent up all the Jones." Jones was the Grace's mother, the White's mother, the Mars mother, the Crossy's mother. We're all Jones, all sisters.
In 1931, Kilkenny were back in the All-Ireland final again. The final against Cork caught the imagination of the country by going to a second replay.
Laurie was captain also in 1931. And the second day he got a rather bad injury, 3 broken ribs, and he missed out on the third day. And anyway, he made amends in 33 and 35.
Walesers were new, comparatively new. And this postman, Bill Muldowney, he lived out there beyond. I'll show you the place just across the road. And he made up his own wireless. He was very clever.
My mother bought a red Guernsey. You don't hear much about Guernseys now at the present time, but it was a red Guernsey. Fishermen wear them a lot. But it was the red for colours for Cork anyway. And we all big crowd down to O'Connell's. They had the weather set. And I remember quietly, I was up in the halfway in the banisters of the stairs listening to the weather.
And there'd be long pauses, and he wouldn't say anything. And himself and Lonely Mar weren't great at all. And in 1931, God, I said to a bushy of mine, Tom Tane, "I'd know his Mar hurling at all."
All of a sudden, full stop, the batteries failed. So we had to rush out, and it was about 200 yards down where a man by the name of Teddy O'Brien had the wireless set out on the window. And there was a huge crowd there listening to it. So we sat down the grass.
My father went off to the hurling on Saturday evening along with the master. He was secretary of the hurling club, Dan Brennan, a great master here. And when I got him gone, I appealed to my mother, and she consented and gave me her bike, and I wasn't even able to sit on the saddle, but I pedalled on the pedals into town and got there. and got home safe.
That particular day, I had 5 bob in my pocket starting off. The train fare was 0.5 crown. It was 1 shilling to go into Croke Park, and you had 1 and 6 pence to spend. And that was, and you had a good day. But you got back about 3 o'clock in the morning. There was no such thing as timetables or anything like that, you know.
The ferry boat hold in Cork pretty well that day. And a ball went down the left wing. Okay, Kelly men went to a third one after the other. And whatever happened, the ball passed the toe. And Paddy Delay was in the corner, and Paddy Delay got it and scored a goal. That was the turning point of the match.
The 30s was a golden era for Kilkenny. They were beaten, as you say, in 31 after 2 replays. Still the only All-Ireland to go to 2 replays. And indeed, many people contend that was the All-Ireland final that made hurling. Came back then and won in 32, won in 33. And that 33 team was the first Kilkenny team to win the league in All-Ireland double. And that team was captained by Neddy Doyle of Bunkhain, not related to the three other Doyles, but a wonderful hurler. And his son Noel became a famous man in our club, and where we're standing here this evening, the building in the background there is dedicated to the memory of the late Noel Doyle.
You'd never be selected in Kilkenny. You were the best hurler in Europe and come from another county. They came here from Tipperary, the best men, and they win all out of Tipperary. And they were hurling with Dixborough and James Stevens and all the rest. They were never... It's just strange. I don't know why now. I don't know what is the reason. But it's happened now. And facts are facts.
Kilkenny people are ravaged with black and amber from the day they were born. And I always said that if fathers couldn't be inter-county hurlers, the first ambition they have for their kids is to be on the Kilkenny team. And like down the west of Ireland, there's an old saying that if we make Mary a nun and we'll make Paddy a priest, and the rest of them can look after themselves. And in Kilkenny, that kind of whole religion scenario takes a different twist. In Kilkenny, it's we'll make him a centre forward, and at worst, he could be a corner back.
The following year, Kilkenny beat Dublin in the Leinster final. Clare, who had lost the Munster finals of 27, 28 and 30, finally made the big breakthrough by beating Cork, the All-Ireland champions.
And then they met Galway, a very handy Galway team, in the Gaelic grounds in Limerick. At half-time, there's varying reports, we were 15 points down, we were 13 points down, but we were certainly down 3 or 4 goals.
Tull Considine started and they could. He kept blowing balls into the net like nobody's business. And Clare won the match.
I think there was a record crowd, something around 30,000 at the final against Kilkenny. Kilkenny were a blend of Lowry Maher, the experience of Lowry Maher, and maybe some more youthful players. And in a very tight first half, again Tommy Daly reports indicate Kilkenny was in the match.
Clare led by a point at half-time. 3 subsequent goals seemed to send Kilkenny on their way. But Clare rallied. With 2 minutes to go, Tull again plucked the ball out of the sky.
And there are two versions. One, that he was pushed in the back, which was obviously the Clare version. But the Kilkenny version was that he got this superb shoulder, which just knocked him off the ball, and the ball trickled out wide, and Kilkenny broke up field and scored the third point, which won the match.
In 1933, Kilkenny won their first league final against Limerick, and also beat the Shannon Siders in the All-Ireland final. A great goal by lovely Johnny Dunn was the difference between the teams. Kilkenny beat Offaly, Laois and Galway on the way to meeting Limerick in the 1935 final. Kilkenny held on to win by 1 point in a downpour.
A record crowd of 51,000 packs Dublin's great stadium for the big day of the Irish hurling year. The same two clubs as last year are fighting out the final, Limerick nearest the crowds and Kilkenny. And last year Kilkenny won. But they only managed it by 1 point, so this year it looks as if the fight will be tougher than ever. Right from the start, Kilkenny attack, and within 3 minutes, they're 1 point up. But Limerick fight back, and the end comes with Limerick winners by 5 goals and 6 points to Kilkenny's 1 goal and 5.
Kilkenny got to the final again in 1937. This time the final was played in Killarney, as the Cusack stand was being built, and completion was delayed because of a strike.
Over 44,000 people at the Fitzgerald Stadium watched the senior All-Ireland hurling final. The occasion is rather an historic one. It marks the close of the 50th Championship and the first time the final has been played outside Croke Park for 30 years. The tussle is between Tipperary and Kilkenny.
Lowry came on in the match in Killarney, so there's nothing he could do.
He was a wonderful striker. I couldn't ever recall